wah luar biasa.
Novi.
Hey, Bu Prof, di mobil, Bu Prof.
Iya, gue lagi mobil, gila macet banget. Waduh. Eh, itu
Jangan
dikasih
nyetir
lagi.
loh.
Iya.
Jangan sambil nyetir loh.
Bisa sambil nyetir ya.
Wah,
Kalau...
keren sekali.
itu lo dikasih lagu-lagu atau apa gitu biar nggak sepi gitu loh.
Ya, lagu apa? Lagu dangdut, Bu Novi.
Jangan, Bu Novi suruh kan apa kayak gitu.
Ya.
Arfan kasih lagu. Arfan nyanyi.
Karaokean aja Bu Novi. Saya tak setting yang pas.
Baru nunggu prof-profnya berdatang. Bu Novi, hari apa tuh aku harusnya harus bilang sama Widat ini?
Ya sebentar, yang hari Rabu itu Prof Hendro cuma bisa satu. Gitu.
Hari Rabu? Ya Allah, si Widat belum selesai bikinnya kali, stresnya gue.
Iya, makanya kan yang hari Rabu biar diisi Ajeng dulu toh, karena Ajeng udah siap. Yeah. Tapi cuma bisa satu memang hari Rabu itu, jadi nanti diplotin lagi ke hari lain. Nanti konfirmasi ke Prof Hendro harinya apa.
Ya udah, soalnya nanti isi sebelum tanggal 20 November ya, berarti sebelum minggu depan.
Yang Dr. Val juga kok, dia misalnya juga yang awal November gitu, jadi yang sidang sama seminarnya juga baru bisa itu.
Emang boleh? Terakhir SPJ tanggal berapa?
Apanya?
SPJ tanggal 20 November ya? Bukan 20 Oktober ya?
Moso Oktober? Berarti harus. Ntar tanyain dulu ke Mbak Endri.
WSU itu terakhirnya kapan gitu loh, berakhir programnya? Aku kan tanggal 20, tapi aku lupa 20 November atau 20 Oktober. Katanya November kali ya. Gak tau deh gue.
Bu Novi lipsticknya bersinar.
Apa?
Oh iya. Ini virtual backgroundnya harus dimatiin karena nggak bisa.
HD-nya dimatiin dong. Udah dicoba.
Udah. Oh.
Berarti kayak laptop gue yang satu lagi yang putih itu juga gitu, sama HD-nya dimatiin tetap aja nggak bisa. Tapi kalau yang hitam yang Lenovo HD-nya dimatiin jadi bagus.
Udah nih, tetap aja nggak bisa. Berarti harus beliin Lenovo ke aku.
Coba coba lu, lu lihat ya tuh, coba lihat tuh, lu lihat tuh. Coba pakai itu. Oh, lagi di kampus loh.
Iya, ini kan pinjam mejanya Bu Prof.
Oh, alah.
Bu, Pak Arfan, Bu Manik, tolong di set sebagai co-host dong.
Ya udah, asal nggak itu. Ya wes, aku pakai pasang pakai laptop, pakai handphone dulu.
Ya. Bu Mani udah join, Bu Mani.
Udah kok tadi.
Sudah, tapi saya masih di jalan.
Kok saya masih? Lu di jalan mana?
Dari Merdeka.
Gue pikir tuh ini
lagi di ATM. Saya pasif dulu ya, nanti pakai laptop. Sekarang masih pakai HP soalnya.
Oh, namanya siapa ini, Bu Mani ini?
Sini. Hah? Chandra. Mai Chandra, Pak.
Oh, enggak. Enggak nemu saya Manik Man Chandra sini.
Oh, nanti aja Pak. Ya.
Biasanya nama apa nama?
Nama kesayangannya Pak Arfan lah buat Bu Manik apa gitu loh.
Kok itu Bu Prof itu loh.
Lo terjemahin sana lo. Lo batuk kan gimana sih lu, kurang minggir, kurang bundar no, masa kepalanya hanya kelihatan gitu doang.
Nih pakai kacamata, kalau gini nggak kelihatan, gue tulisannya nggak kelihatan.
Kacamata saya pakai kacamata.
Pakai kacamata tapi masih juga nggak kelihatan, anu pakai pusing gitu lo.
Operasi katarak sana lo. Nah, gitu kan bagusan gitu loh.
Ini background-nya enggak hijau, jadi waduh, background-nya di kamar enggak apa-apa ya.
HD-nya matiin.
HD-nya dimatiin.
Di video itu HD-nya matiin. Terus atur pencahayaan.
Oh, ini. HD di video dimatiin ya.
Cobain.
Udah bisa dimatiin malah ini.
Oh ya, bisa tuh. Jangan diklik.
Oh, ini udah ngeklik sendiri ini ya.
Well, lu ilangin apa kliknya.
Udah diklik nggak bisa ini. Nggak bisa.
Itu ada jendela sih. Gimana sih background? Pakai background tapi kelihatan jendela sama kursi, sama jendela
oh, gitu. Belakangnya ada hijau masalahnya. Kalau hijau bisa kelihatan utuh. Jadi yang hijau itu yang kelihatan.
Makanya kalau bisa kolom aja. Kolom
nah, ini perlu bikin ruangan khusus ini. Kayak tempatnya Bu Prof dulu.
Saya nanti aku di rumah pakai background. Berarti pagi udah nyoba bagus kok. Ini baru sampai kira-kira 15 menit lagi sampai rumah. Aku pikir tuh di Jakarta macet amat. Gara-gara Anies buka PSBB-nya. Ternyata ada truk mogok. Astagfirullahaladzim.
Ini kalau gini terlalu dekat ya. Tapi kalau anu nggak kelihatan tulisannya kalau pakai kacamata. Kelihatan.
Lalu kalau ngetik gimana caranya kalau nggak gitu? Berarti lo ngetik
kayak gini. Ngetik ya pakai kacamata ya gini, dekat laptop. Gini.
Kayaknya gue juga sama.
Ini nggak kelihatan ini. Kalau besar internasional webinar masih kelihatan, tapi judulnya nggak kelihatan.
Judulnya ketik dulu.
Assalamualaikum.
Waalaikumsalam. Pak Sadikin.
Jam berapa tadi sana, Pak?
Jam 7.
Papa itu posisinya di mana ya?
Di Eindhoven.
Oh, iya.
Di Belanda.
Iya, masih jam 7 pagi ya.
Ini iya. Pak Val ini background-nya hijau ya Pak Val ya?
Oh, enggak.
Background kamarnya hijau.
Oh, enggak, putih.
Putih. Loh,
kok bisa anu nggak kelihatan ya? Oh putih ya. Saya kok.
Iya.
Saya tembok eh apa jenenge jendelane ketok.
Oh gitu ya. Oh iya ya, baru sadar. Tapi kok posisi saya ini ya top universe enggak kebalik ya tulisannya.
Ya tulisannya betul. Tapi kalau di tempatnya Pavel kebalik.
Oh gitu ya. Oh ya.
Cermin ya.
Ya, soalnya mungkin saya mirror ya ininya, apanya?
Mirror. Ini Pavel sudah menusantara sekarang.
Enggak juga. Itu cuman banyak teman-teman yang ngundang aja.
Nah, iya. Sabang sampai Merauke, Pak. Gimana Ega? Ega aja join, Ega.
Hadir, Pak.
Hadir. Gimana kabarnya, Ega? Sehat, Ega?
Alhamdulillah, sehat.
Videonya dinyalain, dong, Ega.
Jadi di sana itu enggak ini ya? Belum masuk sama sekali mahasiswa, Pak?
Sudah, cuman online.
Oh, cuman online. Jadi kasihan kampus ya, enggak ada yang isi ya? Kampus gede, enggak ada yang...
Yang kasihan itu pedagang gorengan, Pak.
Oh, iya, iya, benar ya. Enggak ada yang beli.
Kampusnya buat kuliah dunia lain sekarang.
Enggak tahu kapan berakhirnya, enggak ada ciri-ciri. Jadi kalau kasus di Belanda itu, kemarin kita sudah masuk kantor, sekitar 1 bulan, terus setelah itu sekarang kantor ditutup lagi. Karena di Belanda, khusus Belanda, bukan Jerman, Belgia ya, kalau Belanda itu justru kasusnya lebih naik sedikit ya, enggak separah kemarin, tapi akhirnya ya itu. Pemerintah putuskan di lockdown lagi.
Wah, Bu Novi.
Yang mana sausnya?
Halo, Bu Novi.
Itu tangan atas. Sama saus tadi sih. Enggak.
Mau bawa, Pak. Kantornya di mana, Pak?
High Tech Campus, Eindhoven.
Oh, bawa aja nih, kalau bawa sama saya. Gimana sih, Pak? Bawa aja, coba lihat,
Pak. Gimana?
Di sana tuh ini apa ya? Satu lantai memang pilih semua atau...
Oh enggak, jadi ada satu wilayah besar, kurang lebih 1 hektar, itu banyak semuanya institut riset, ada Philips, ada Signify, kemudian ada TU Eindhoven juga di sana, kemudian ada TNO itu lembaga riset di Belanda yang terkenal, ada banyak, kurang lebih ada sekitar 150-an institut di sana. Ya di sana ada fasilitas macam-macam termasuk fasilitas olahraga, restoran, terus tempat cukur ada ya semuanya seperti satu wilayah besar kan. Ada tuh videonya di YouTube saya.
Apa Pak namanya, Pak?
Sebentar. Namanya itu sebentar ya.
Bunovi, halo Bunovi.
The Sex Scientist.
Gimana?
Sudah tahu kabarnya Ega belum, Bu Novi?
Ega lamaran.
Allahu Akbar, amin.
Oke, tanyain Bu Novi juga.
Ada info apa, Ega? Kamu kok nggak lapor ke saya?
Pak Arman, ya nanti di belakang ya, Bu, ya.
Ega, tolong di set co-host dong. Ega, tolong bantuin share screen ya. Untuk yang ini flyernya.
Baik Ibu.
Thank you.
Mac co-host. Oke, dah.
Iya, matiin ya. Karena kalau dimatiin di YouTube-nya juga jadi mati hitam.
Ya, Ega sudah co-host.
Aku satu lantai sama Fox, Pak.
Apa itu? Apa namanya? Jadi itu...
Kospis namanya.
Kalau nggak salah itu ada di wilayah ET Kampus itu. Jadi kan ada sekitar 150, hampir 160, semuanya institut riset semua. Termasuk dari Huawei, ada IBM, ada Intel juga di sana. Jadi semuanya jadi satu. Jadi tidak satu lantai. Jadi kalau gedung kami itu sendiri, khusus Philips Lighting ya, Signify.
Oh, Philipsnya lighting, oke. Okay.
Iya. Jadi di IoT lighting.
Berarti beda ya Pak ya kalau sama mother and child care terus sama yang
pernah
lain-lain.
Pernah ke HT kampus nggak? Pernah ke sana? Pernah ada atau?
Enggak Pak, saya dulu di Philips Batam.
Oh, Philips Batam.
Ini alumni pegawai Philips Pak.
Oh gitu ya.
Makanya sering kalau misalkan yang dari Eindhoven tuh sama Monique Kors, sama Kumar, sama Volts.
Oh gitu. Soalnya kalau tempat saya itu Philips Lighting sudah split out sama Philips yang utama karena kita nggak setuju sama cross funding. Kebetulan kan kalau kalau funding profit itu saat 2017 kami lebih banyak kan. Jadi kita tidak mau lagi apa cross funding sama departemen lain. Jadi berdiri sendiri sekarang.
Oh, baik,
nah, sekarang
Pak.
Karena berdiri sendiri namanya ganti Signify, tapi ya produknya masih Philips, semuanya Philips, lampu IoT, kemudian home appliance itu masih ini masih Philips namanya. Jadi nama produknya nggak ganti tapi nama perusahaannya ganti, namanya Signify.
Oh, baik, Pak.
Ayo pakai backgroundnya.
Ah, diin laptop dulu.
Pak, itu background kongres.
Pak
Porto. Ega kok kelihatan
gimana
cuma
Pak?
Cuma ada kok hitam-hitam kayak hantu itu.
Ega iya, lagi Pak, bahagia. Pak Heru, Ega lagi bahagia Pak Heru.
Kenapa sih? Bosen nih kayaknya. Udah bosen di kampus nih, udah bosen di rumah kayaknya Pak Arfan.
Kemarin habis jemput.
Pulang.
Pulang ke sini udah pulang.
Oh, pantes. Kemarin tuh tak WA tuh balasnya tuh malam-malam loh.
Ya Allah, Bu Novi.
Gimana coba? Oh iya, Pak Fal, untuk ya? Jadwal seminar sama sidang kalau kira-kira di bulan Oktober masih bisa enggak ya, Pak? Kemarin saya di pengumuman sih katanya baru bisa awal November ya, Pak.
Ya, saya baru bisa awal November, soalnya akhir bulan ini saya agak padat sama seminar.
Oke. Okay.
Sebentar saya cek lagi mungkin. Yeah. Itu sebenarnya sidang agendanya apa sih sebenarnya detailnya itu?
Sidang memberi masukan, saran penelitian mahasiswa gitu Pak, sekitar 1 sampai 1 setengah jam gitu.
Tanggal
penguji tamu Pak.
Oh, penguji tamu ya. Ya mungkin slot akhir Oktober mungkin bisa nggak? Tapi bukan minggu depan. Dari tanggal 26 sampai 30 Oktober.
Oke, kita ngikut jadwalnya Pak Fal aja. Karena kebetulan program kita kan berakhirnya di akhir Oktober. Jadi
oh,
semua
gitu.
Kan harus selesai di bulan Oktober ini kalau bisa.
Ya mungkin kayak semacam kayak Senin hari hari Senin mungkin ya Senin pagi dini hari.
Boleh. Ya,
sekitar nanti, jam 6 apa jam 7 waktu Eindhoven ya.
Iya, iya. Nanti kita konfirm lagi via Bu Manik ya, Pak Pak.
Iya, iya.
Terima kasih.
Tapi ada yang tetap ke kampus ya. Kalau ya, kalau di Undip.
Saya di kampus nih, Pak Purnawan juga di kampus, Bu Ratna.
Oh gitu.
Kampus. Tapi kalau mahasiswa memang nggak boleh sama sekali sih.
Oh gitu ya.
Paling kalau bimbingan kepaksa banget baru boleh ke kampus. Kalau enggak ya online aja.
Tapi kedengarannya Semarang itu case-nya nggak terlalu tinggi mungkin kalau kalau
COVID. Oh, kemarin merah, Pak.
Hah?
Merah kemarin.
Oh merah ya?
Oh kemarin enggak. Ke orange sih, tapi nggak tahu juga ya.
Yang sering dibahas itu kalau di media kan Jakarta sama Surabaya biasanya paling paling sering.
Surabaya udah turun sekarang kayaknya.
Oh gitu ya?
Semarang ya, kemarin sempat merah sih. Katanya sih sekarang udah turun ke orange. Cuman ya beberapa kasus itu agak unik karena itulah ada orang-orang yang mungkin agak pemikirannya agak aneh gitu, jadi dia malah jalan-jalan ke mall gitu. Jadi
bikin oh gitu. Ya mirip seperti Belanda juga malah naik kasusnya sekarang. Jadi sempat kita sudah HT kampus itu sudah masuk semua, kita sudah kerja di kantor lagi. Terus sekarang ditutup lagi kantornya.
Jadi WFH semua lagi, Pak. Enggak ada sama sekali kantor.
Enggak masuk sama sekali kecuali yang ini yang di manufaktur ya. Mereka harus masuk karena produksi harus tetap jalan, tapi kalau yang riset ya di rumah semua.
Oke.
Sudah jam 7 kayaknya nih.
Mau dimulai aja, Pak Arfan?
Jam 12.15 atau mulainya atau jam berapa? Jam 12 atau 12.15? Kalau di jadwal 12.15.
Ya, ditunggu aja kalau gitu. Ngobrol-ngobrol aja dulu.
Sambil nunggu Prof. Hendra sebentar ya. Belum masuk juga. Suhunya udah sampai berapa, Pak Val, di Eindhoven?
Apanya?
Suhunya udah sampai berapa grad sekarang?
Oh enggak, belum ini. Belum masuk winter kan. Masih musim gugur.
Oke, masih
ya,
belasan. Masih
sekitar ya belasan lah. Kadang-kadang ya di bawah 10, tapi masih di 15-an rata-ratanya.
Kita mulai, Pak Arfan.
Mulai, Pak Hendro sudah masuk. Pak Hendro
sudah masuk. Pak Arfan sudah ready juga.
Ya, boleh. Silakan, Bu Novi.
Okay, we will start the international webinar today. First of all, let me introduce. My name is Novi Susanto. I am the PIC of the World Class University Program, and today we would like to conduct an international webinar, Quality Education Partnership for the Goals. I would thank to Prof. Dr. Engineer Wisenzaf Hendro Wicaksono and also Dr. Renat Val Sadikin for coming to this event and share your knowledge and your experience about the topics. Okay, we will start the webinar, and I send Dr. Rer Ekonom Arfan Bakhtiar as the moderator. Dear Pak Arfan, the time is yours. Thank you.
Okay, thank you very much, Dr. Novi. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Waalaikumsalam.
Guten Morgen, Prof. Hendro. Selamat pagi, hadirin semua. Good afternoon. Today, we will conduct a webinar, international webinar. We have two speakers for today. First is Dr. Renat Val Sadikin, and the second is Professor Dr. Ing Hendro Wicaksono. Before we start for the first presenter, I will explain or read the curriculum vitae of the first presenter for Dr. Val Sadikin. One moment for share the curriculum vitae. Oke. Okay. Dr. Fal Sadikin, got a doctoral degree from Freie University, Berlin. And the master degree in Gajah Mada University. And the bachelor degree from Gajah Mada University also. And based on curriculum vitae, we can see that Professor Dr. Fal Sadikin have several conference proceeding and journal. And now he work in Philip Eindhoven in the field security system. And the participant can find the curriculum vitae in a chat room. And I think for more detail, you can read the curriculum vitae in chat room. All right. Dr. Fal Sadikin, you have 30 minutes for 30 minutes until 35 minutes for presentation, and please share your material of presentation. Thank you very much.
So yeah, so I cannot share the screen right now. Anyone can enable for me?
Make the Dr. Fal as co-host to he to share screen.
Okay, that's possible now.
Okay.
So anyone can see my screen right now?
Okay.
Yes.
So thank you for the introduction. So today I will be presenting the topic for patenting your research invention. Basically, I will touch a little bit reflection for the pandemic year, but the main purpose today is actually to encourage university or academia to start patenting their research project or research invention. So let me start from the case of COVID bankruptcy. So we know that this year we have seen a lot of acceleration of the company getting bankruptcy. The speed is the increased number of bankruptcies, the number that we have never seen before. We can see that some of the company getting acquired or merger to another company or reorganization to other company, and some of them also even close for good or for close forever. So we can start from April, for example. We can see in US particularly there are a lot of number of company filing for bankruptcy. For example, we can see the big one is Frontier Communication. This is basically telecom and media technology. And they have asset about 17 billion. And then in May, there are several big company also filing for bankruptcy. Most of them for travel and lodging and leisure. What we can see here, for example, the big one is Hertz with 25 billion asset. They file for organization at 22 May. And then in June, there are also a lot of company. One the biggest one is in the field of energy, like Chapsex Energy. So they file for bankruptcy with asset more than 16 billion US dollar. And then in July, there are still a lot of company filing for bankruptcy. One of them is a retail and restaurant. It is Ascena Retail. They have asset something like more than 13 billion US dollar. And then goes to the August, we can see here also still there are a lot of company filing for bankruptcy. It is one of them is Valaris with the asset bigger than it's the asset is about a certain billion US dollar. And now in September the number is keep increasing. One of the biggest one is Garrett Mason. It is the company working in industrial and material. We can see they have asset about $2 billion US dollar. So what happened? So the basically the expert think that this number will keep increasing. So we will see a lot of company in the future will go bankruptcy if the case of corona or pandemic is not stopped immediately. So this is basically what we see on the 10 industry with bankruptcy in 2020. We can see that most of them, for sure, the restaurant because of the lockdown case. But we can see also some of banking and finance, telecommunication, and oil and gas, also medical and healthcare. So what we can learn from this? What we can learn from this? Basically, of course, there are a lot of aspects that make them goes to bankruptcy. But basically, what we can learn. Most of the company because they don't have intellectual property or less intellectual property or they don't have passive money or passive income. So if we go to the reflection of the best company in the world, for example, we can see that Patent Insight issued the list of 100 the best 100 company in the world. Like for example, here we can see that list is based on the number of patent that I fill it every year by the company. We can see here that, for example, Philips is in number 17, which is the best company in the world because they fill a lot of patent in 2019. And you can see also Signify, which is part of, before it is part of Philips, it is on 68. So what we can learn that we can survive. This all this company is good company. We can survive because we have intellectual property, which means that we still have passive money. Even maybe so we don't really only rely on the service or product that we sell, but we have to also passive money. I will explain later how the patent work basically. So we get a lot of money from patent. So basically, the main idea today for presentation is to encourage university to start patenting their research invention because you know that we know that there are several ranking in best university in the world based on their citation or based on the paper, but actually there is also a top university based on their granted patent. In for example, the granted patent in US, you can see that this is the list of the university. For sure, that most of them are university from United States because this is about ranking for U.S. patent. But you can see also some of the university also coming from Korea, South Korea, also from Saudi Arabia and other country in Asia. So basically, what I want to say here actually, we have chance also to get patent. So I encourage university to start filling their patent, to patenting their research invention. I think this is good. I will explain later on why we need to patent. So basically, what is patent? So and why every good engineer or researcher need one? So basically, engineering or research work is about solving real world problem. So when you try to solve the real world problem, you will learn this kind of creativity there. So what is and then actually patent is something like stamp from the government that that recognize your creativity in solving a problem. Basically, that's a patent. So it is the same, like for example, like a student. For example, you have chance to go to the let's say you register your continue your study to master degree at industrial engineering department. Let's say from Diponegoro University, for example, and you learn the same textbooks there, and then you learn from the same list of high qualified lecturer, for example, there, and then you learn the same technique. But at the end. As a student, for example, or an individual, you will have always the different way to solve the problem because you have different brain. Like for example, one of student try to strike forward to solve the problem. The other student try to solve the problem in elegant way, or another student maybe try just to bypass the problem itself. But what I want to say here, because you are different personality, you have different brain, you may solve different. You may have kind of a fingerprint, so the way you solve the problem and the way you see the problem. So basically it's similar like an art actually. They have their own unique way to solve the problem. So that's the patent actually. So when once you have the way to solve the problem, and then that's the things that can be patent, either the way the method you solve the problem, or maybe the way you produce the tool to solve the problem. So I will give one example here. Like you know, Jefferson Memorial use case. I just want to give example. Actually, every problem may have different point of view and may have different way to solve the problem. So, I mean, that's the idea of patent. You know that this is one of the famous museum in Washington DC, United States. So they have actually in the past they have a serious problem, which is deteriorating problem. When you see most of the corner of the building and most of the part of the building is getting deteriorated there. So you know that of course when we see this problem, we know how to solve it. There's a lot of possible way to see the problem. Maybe some of students will come up with one idea. For example, we can solve the problem by redecorating the building, for example. Or maybe we can develop like robotic system or drone to automatically solve the problem or redecorating the building. So that's also possible. So there are a lot of things to solve the problem. But maybe another student have different point of view. For example, here. Like they can check why the building is deteriorating, because basically in the past they need to clean this building once every 2 weeks with high flow water water flow, and then maybe another student will come up with the solution, another solution. Like for example, they can try to invent the way to make a better cleaner, for example without a high flow injection that can deteriorate the building, or maybe they can find the way to new method to clean the building. That's also a possible way to patent, for example. And then maybe another student come up with another idea. For example, they will ask the question why they need to clean every 2 weeks, for example, because the case is because the building has a lot of beer dropping there. Why? Because this building always get visiting from a larger number of bird or of pigeon during the day. So maybe another student will come up with another solution. For example, they may try to develop kind of trowman to prevent the bird coming to the building, or maybe they will provide solution like maybe placing a spike fence to prevent the building to prevent the pigeon landing to the building, or maybe they can provide like drone, for example, to prevent the bird coming to the building. For example, this is also another solution, and we can solve the problem. But maybe another student come up with different point of view. Maybe they will ask why the building get a lot of visiting from pigeon, especially during the day. And the reason is because they see that, oh yeah, that's because that's one, the building is home of large number of spider. There are a lot of spider, which is the source food of the bird. That's one of the example there. So in this case, maybe another student will come up the solution with the solution. Like for example, they will try to invent something to prevent the spider. Like for example, they can invent something like chemical substance to prevent the spider living on the building, or they can also kill the spider using the building chemical substance, or they can also invent something like electromagnetic wave to kick all the spider away from the building. Of course, this can be patent as well. So, and then maybe another student will come up with another solution with or another point of view of the problem. For example, they will ask the question why there are a lot of spider inside the building, and then they will see like, oh yeah, because during afternoon, particularly, there are a lot of visiting from swarm insect in the building. So this is kind of food for the spider itself. So they get trapped to the spider web, and then the spider will eat them. So this is actually the source food of the spider. And then another student maybe come up with the solution. For example, they will try to invent method to prevent the insect to visiting the building, for example, like by using chemical prevention or maybe even UV lighting prevention, just to prevent the swarm insect visiting the building. this is one example. So we have a lot of, with one problem, we can see a lot of point of view, and we can one in one point of view, we can have a lot of solution there. That's the things that we can patent, less or more. And maybe another student will come up with another point of view. For example, they will ask the question, why there is a lot of visiting insect during afternoon to the Jefferson Museum. And then they will check, oh yeah, because they get attracted with the lighting system of the building. And then maybe another student will think, maybe we can find the way of the method to prevent visiting from the insect by changing the lighting system. So basically, this is the real solution that used by the building maintenance there in the museum. So they change the lighting solution there. They delay the lighting 1 hour after sunset, which means that by using this kind of trick, they can reduce the visiting insect until 90%, which means that in general they kill the supply chain, and then they don't really need the frequent cleaning anymore, so they can preserve the building. So in general, here what happened? So we know that the building get deteriorating problem, and this is because they need to clean the building once every 2 weeks with high flow injection, because they need to clean all the dropping dirt. What happened there? Because the Jefferson Museum get visiting a lot of bird during the day, particularly pigeon, and then they make a bird drop there. And then why they get a lot of visiting building? Because there's a food for the bird there, which is spider. So the building is basically is home of the spider. Why there are a lot of spider? Because this is they get food from the visiting insect during the day. Why there are a lot of visiting spider during the day? Because they get attracted with the lighting system of the museum. So what is the solution actually? What I say before, this is the real solution. Like they try to delay the lighting system or the light up the system 1 hour after sunset. So this method actually, this is the cheap method and very effective method to prevent the visiting of the insects, which means that because the close the supply food of the spider, the population of spider there also decrease significantly. Because the population of spider decrease significantly, they also prevent the number of visiting bird during the day, because there is no food anymore. Because the pigeon doesn't visit, most of pigeon do not visit the building anymore, so they don't need to have the frequent cleaning anymore, which means that they can preserve the museum. So that's the way I give. This is example how we can see a lot one problem with a different point of view, and how we can solve the lot of problem. We can have unique solution for each different point of view. That's what I think. Actually, maybe every student or every researcher or even every engineer may come up with different solution for one problem. So that's the patent actually. So maybe I don't know whether the patent this idea, but actually this is the real solution that they apply to the building. So they just the solution they don't spend a lot of money. They just delay the lighting system 1 hour after sunset. So it is very effective to prevent the bird visiting the building because there is no food anymore there. So I hope that's clear. So basically, what is patent actually? So patent is something like a word about your creativity, your unique solution for specific problem. That's patent. But most patent basically most of them is engineering work or research work. So maybe we can similarity see like patent is something like a book for an author, or something like a masterpiece for an artist. Or we can see also patent is something like publication for your research. Basically, it is similar. So you can imagine, like you describe your invention there, like a blog, for example. You describe your problem and your solution, and you publish to the world. I think we can see this is something like a publish, but on technical point of view. So that is patent. So I will give one example here. For example, we can see one simple patent from Amazon. It is invented in 1997. It is about one-click patent. You know that maybe I think most of you already use Amazon web service. I mean Amazon online service for online shopping. So we know that they invent something like called technique called buy now with one click, which means that once you buy your shopping there, what you choose for your purchasing, you don't need to fill in your credit card anymore. You don't need to fill in your address anymore. But you just need to doing one click because it's already previous stored before. So basically, this is very cool idea. And then because this is very cool idea, actually Apple iTunes also buy this idea. So when you visit Apple iTunes, maybe you know that you don't need to enter your credit card anymore. You don't need enter any detail there. You just need to one click and then you go. You get what you want. So basically this idea, you can imagine some of patent actually can be very rewarding because if it is used, the copyright is used or the idea is by other company, then they need to pay to you. So basically, patent is something like, maybe what is patent itself, but in technically, basically patent is something like a deal between the inventor and the government. It's something like that. So basically here the inventor teach the world how to use the technology, how to solve the problem. And in consequence, the government will give the exclusive right. I will explain more detail what is exclusive right you can get from government by filling the patent. But basically the one example there, like for example, other party that use the solution that you invent, like for example, Apple use a solution from Amazon, they need to pay a lot of money to Amazon. So which is kind of passive income for them. I hope that's clear. So basically, the this is mutual. That's why I try to always encourage university or even student, not only researcher there, but student, to try to start to patenting their invention. For example, here, because the benefit first for the inventor is they may get a lot of money. Of course, depends on the case, because not every patent can attract money, but but few of them even can attract million US dollar per year. And then the benefit for the public, they can learn what you are doing, what your invention. So what I want to say here, this is similar like publication. So you publish your invention, and then the world will learn about your solution. Some of them may use it, and maybe you get benefit there by having the revenue. So maybe we can see similar like in real estate a company. Like for example, there is a owner and tenant. Then once the owner pay the fee for renting the apartment, you can sue, you can use the apartment, and once you don't need it anymore, you can just leave it. So you stop the payment there. It is you can imagine something like that. It is kind of a real estate agency. So there are a lot of myth in patent. The myth number one, you must be genius to fill in the patent. Yeah, for sure that some of inventor is extremely genius like Nikola Tesla, but that's not always true. And then the myth number two, you need a lot of money to patent your invention. Yeah, in some part it is true, but it's not 100% true actually. What I want to say here, for example here, this is a research about patent. So they can find out actually for patent, only 2% of the invention is the pioneering or really invention. The other, like for example, 75% of the patent, basically it is improvement for the previous technology. And you can see also 15% of the patent, it is just routine solution. I can give you example here, like what I previously show about a one-click patent from Amazon. Basically, this is not really genuine technology. It is apparent technology, but it was already there for some times. But because Amazon is the first one that patent this technology, so they're the one that get award for the patent, then get a lot of money because of this. So that's the idea actually. So you don't have to be really genius to do that. Maybe you can just find a routine activity that people don't think to patent before. So you can, so either you just try to find, just solve the real life problem, or maybe you just improve the existing solution. Like for example, in some of my patent actually that I'll refit, it's just about improvement of wireless security. So I try to find weaknesses in security or weaknesses in IoT product, and then I find the solution there. I try to find solution in unique way according to my the way I solve the problem, and then I fill in the patent in European Union patent. It's something like that. So it is denied the myth number one. So you don't have to really genius to be able to fill in the patent. And second one, the myth, another myth in patent is like, you must be very rich. It is not completely true, because you know that if you are individual person, or maybe you come from university, you will get kind of, some of government actually give a discount. You just need to pay quarter of the fee for having the patent. Like for, of course, you don't need to pay like what big company pay, like how Amazon pay to the big to the patent office, or how Philips pay to the patent office. But if you register as individual or as a student, you will get a lot of discount here to fill in your patent. So why do you need patent? Especially, this is also especially encouragement for student, because if you have patent, of course, it is immediately differentiate you from the crowd. It is important for you if you apply a job, they will see in the CV, you have already patent, and then you kind of, they will think that you are kind of smart people. So this is very important actually. Not only for the student, also for the researcher, lecturer in the university. If you have patent, so you are kind of different person. And then that's also important for sure, because this is the startup era. If you have patent, of course, it is easier for you to get funding. You know there is a lot of investor outside there that it is not easy for them to spend or to put money to your startup unless you have patent. Some of the company actually they get funding. It's very easy because they, some of the owner of co-invent, sorry, co-founder of the startup already have patent, so it is easier for them to get funding because they already have patent for the idea they have for running the company. And then the good thing of patent actually, what I say before, it can be passive money. So it is not kind of promotion, but this is true actually. But of course, I will not say that every patent can give you passive money. But some of brilliant idea, like let's say we can give the example like one click from Amazon. It is very brilliant idea. It is simple but brilliant. Can get them passive revenue, even can be used for another company to do their business. So basically it is too much time actually to explain everything, but I will explain actually what is patent about. So how the patent typically share the royalty. So most of actually patent can depend on the patent, but they can share like something like 2 to 7% of retail sales. For example, you invent the solution, and the solution used on the product, and then the products cost something like $100, for example, $100. No. So every selling product, every purchasing product, you will have something like $7 for each purchasing product. So you can get something like passive income then. Again, this is not always true for all the patent, but some of the patent can be like this. So when is the time for patent? So you don't have to wait. Just if you have an idea, just go forward, straight forward, and then try to register your idea there. Because maybe another person already have the same idea, and then they already registered that one. That's why, because in patent office, they will kind of treat kind of early bird for get the patent. So who register first, they are the one who will get the granted patent. So like for example, like you know Larry Page. Larry Page found the algorithm for search engine that right now is used by Google. So actually, he filled in the patent when he was in student in Stanford University. So you don't have to wait. If you have already good enough idea, maybe you can start patenting that one. You don't have to wait until you graduate, for example. You just need to, once you get idea and you think it is good enough, and then you just submit the idea, and the patent office will evaluate your idea, whether it is possible to be patent or not, something like that. So here I will give some example, like for example here, Philips Lighting, Signify. We are the one who invent LED technology. For if you see on the market actually, the selling number of Philips Lighting is not so much like Osram or GA or maybe IKEA. But you know what is benefit from us? Every company that try to produce the LED, they need to pay for us for amount of money for every purchasing product there. So which means that even we are not the number one best selling product, but we still get money on that. We'll still get passive money on that. That's the idea. That's why this is make the Philips Lighting or Signify still survive in very difficult situation. Also for other company, like for example here, you know that TV, for example, is another product from another patent held by Philips Lighting. You can see that we invent something like Philips TV Ambilight, where the TV has a light background that mimic the movement on the screen, which is very good to solve the problem because some of the customer actually from TV watcher, the user, have complained about the problem. They are easy to get tired because when they are watching football or they watch TV in very long time period. So because we invent kind of little degradation between the background and the television, which means that it can preserve the eye. So this is our invention, which means that there is no TV, other TV, other than Philips can use this technology, and unless they pay to us. So you will not find it in the market right now because it is just released in the market few years back. But right now, only Philips can produce this kind of technology. Let's say maybe in the future, Sony or LG will produce the technology. They need to pay to us. So that's the idea, actually. So maybe you can see also, maybe some of you already iPhone user, for example. Actually, iPhone need to pay for $1.5 billion US dollar in 2019 because they use Qualcomm technology. Because some of the processor used by Apple there is basically invented by Qualcomm technology. There are a lot of possible benefits, benefit by inventing technology there. So basically, what I want to say in conclusion, like for example, why we need to patent? Because here the one reason is because by having patent, we have more money in and less money out. For example, here, because we have the licensing value, so it is kind of additional income for us. For example, like what I mentioned before, the example of LED lighting, for example, we are not the number one selling for the LED product, but we still get money from the purchasing from another brand. And then the second one, because we have the exclusivity, for example, for the TV Ambilight, we are the only one who produce this kind of product. We have the only one company who have right to produce the manufacture this product. So we will have higher margin on TV Ambilight because so far we are the only one. And then we can reduce the cost because by producing the LED lighting, like for example, another company like Osram, for example, they want to produce the light. They need to pay cross-licensing to us, which means that for us, in our point of view, every time we want to produce the LED lighting, we don't need to pay to other company. And then freedom to operate. This is also most important thing. Because we have the patent, because I will explain later on, we have freedom to operate. What is the benefit of having patent? Like for example, when I have the invention, I have several benefit here. For example, I have the right to do manufacturing around the Europe because we register to European Patent Office. We have right to distribution and we have the right to sales. That's why we have so many rights here. That's why this is also the reason every time we have we invent something, we always register to European Patent Office, to US Patent, India, Japan, and China, most of them. And some of the product we try to register to Russia. But there is you have to take into consideration here because there is a limitation of patent, which is time. So patent basically is only valid for 20 years, which is for example after 20 years everyone can use the technology. Maybe I can give example like Coca-Cola, you know. So it was invented something in I don't remember the year, but after 20 years there are a lot of product with cola come up like Pepsi and other products because the patent itself has limitation of time. About 20 years, something like that. And then there's a limitation about territory. For example, if you only register for our European Union government, so people can still use it on other area like in US. That's why once you have the invention, you need to fill in the patent to all the government all around the world. So that's all the presentations for me. I hope that's clear. If you have any question, please feel free to ask.
Thank you very much for Dr. Fal Sadikin. Nice presentation. And okay, for the all participants, can give question by send via chat or maybe oral. But after the speaker present material of presentation. Okay, the second presenter is Professor Dr. Hendro. Okay, moment please. Please, Dr. Fal.
Maybe let me stop my sharing screen.
Yeah. Okay.
Oh, this one. Sorry.
Okay. Moment, please. Okay. The curriculum vitae of Professor Hendro Wicaksono, Professor Hendro Wicaksono is Professor of Industrial Engineering at Jacob University, Bremen. He got a doctoral degree from Karlsruhe Institute of Technology, and he got a bachelor degree from Bandung Institute of Technology. Professor Hendro Wicaksono published many paper in journal and proceeding. All participants can read the more detail of curriculum vitae from Professor Hendro Wicaksono in chat. And okay, we can start the presentation of Professor Hendro Wicaksono. Please share your presentation. Thank you very much.
Okay, thank you. I cannot share my screen yet. Oh, now I can. Can you see my screen?
Yes.
Yes.
Okay. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Waalaikumsalam.
Good afternoon, everyone in Indonesia. Thank you for the organizer, Pak Arfan, Bu Mani, and so on. To give me the opportunity to share a little bit about my experience in Germany. Today, I would like to share about how we can, as a higher education, we can transform ourselves during the pandemic year. So as you may know that we also in Germany experienced the pandemic, and it was quite, we were quite hard hit in around April and May this year. So I would like to share experience what we have done so far to transform and also to cope with the problem. So this is the content of my today talk. First, I would like to introduce how the higher education system works in Germany. And after that, I would like to have some kind of overview of what are the roles in education, in research and transfer. So this is how we can interpret the three roles of higher education in Germany. So if, for example, in Indonesia, you have this pengabdian masyarakat. So communal contribution or society contribution, but in our case in Germany, it's called transfer, means how to transfer the research results to the society, to the economy, and so, to the business, and so on. And then at the end, I will talk about the how those activities can be transformed during the pandemic year by using some technologies and also the approach that we need to change. So before I start, so I would like to introduce a little bit to my where I work. So Jacobs University is a university in Bremen in northern Germany. So we are quite small university with around 1,500 students, and we are quite young, founded in 2001. But the unique thing in our university is that we have students from 120 plus countries. So that means it's quite multicultural environment in our university. So even we are quite young, but we are quite perform well in the rank. Actually, we don't pursue the rank directly. So this is just we focus on research and also focus on the internationalizations. Even we are still 20 years old, less than 20 years old, we are now number one in category of small university with a student less than 5,000, and also number 10 worldwide. And for young university, we are also perform quite well in top 30 in the world. So young university means the university which has less than 50 years old. About my research group a little bit. So I focus on the data management, which is the core of method and tools. So from data integration, machine learning, and also how to represent the result of the data analytics, machine learning, and also integrated with visualization. Of course, because I work in the area of industrial engineering, so what also important is the innovation technologies and knowledge management and the application of those, and you can see here, in different fields. And our team is quite multicultural too, reflect the university. We have these are the students, so bachelor, master, and PhD student in my research group, and they are from four continents. Yeah. You can see here from Africa, South America, Asia, and also Europe. All right, then I would start with the main topic of today. So what are the main roles or how the higher education work in Germany? So I prepare some quizzes and also some interactions, so in Menti, so you can join also there. Oh, sorry, not this one. So you can connect to this menti.com with this code, and then we can have some kind of interactions, answer some questions, So please spend like 30 seconds to connect to this web. The idea is to have some kind of interaction and keep you also keep us to engage to the topics so that then the output of this webinar today will be optimal. So wait more 10 more seconds. 10, 9, 8, 7, 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. So I'm sorry I have to continue because of the limited time. So the first question, which program is not offered in the polytechnic? Because in Germany there is a polytechnics or University of Applied Science and the general universities. So this is some kind of sekolah vokasi. Yeah, what program is not offered in the polytechnic usually? Yeah, so yes, right. A lot of people answer it correctly. So the higher education in Germany basically can be divided into two main types, but there are also some other types which is quite smaller, like University of Cooperative Education, which more has the dual system form where you can, when the student registered to companies instead of university. So here just to compare the university and University of Applied Science, which is comparable to university and sekolah vokasi or polytechnic in Indonesia. So where the learning activities mostly happen in the campus, on campus. So the difference quite obvious here that the university offer almost off study programs and the University of Applied Science don't offer like professionals and also science-based study program like medicine, or law, natural and teacher education and natural science. So this medicine, teacher education, and law is usually are the most favorite study program that are applied by the German students or German high school graduates. Usually they prefer the good German high school graduates, usually they choose one of these three. And the University of Applied Science doesn't offer any PhD programs because it focuses on the applications of science instead of research theories and sciences. And in learning, the University of Applied Science conduct the learning or the classes in smaller classes comparing to the university. And in the university is quite, the supervision to the students is quite minimum. So that means the student is allowed also not to attend the class, for example, but they have to just pass the final exams. But in University of Applied Science, so like it will be in small classes and the students should attend the class, especially the classes with the practical activities. And what also driven is the lecturer or the professor. So in the university, the professor has to have some kind of research experiences, like working in the company, in the research departments, also did some kind of postdocs, research group leader leadings, and also junior professors, for example. But in a University of Applied Science, the professor have minimum of 5 years experience in the industry. So that means, so the materials that taught to the students based on the experience, how those science are applied in the industry. So, and the relationship between industry and higher education in Germany is quite close. So you can see here the bidirectional relationship between them. So for example, the university get input from the industry. For example, they recruit a professor who has some experiences in industry, in research, or also in some consulting, for example, in the case of University of Applied Science. And also the university can get fundings, research funding, in form of research contract from the industry, and also visiting lecturers. What is important, what is also interesting here is that the accreditation process in the higher education in Germany involves industry. That means the assessor is not just a bunch of professors or experts, but also focus on the user of the higher education service, which are the industry representatives and students also. Students is also the assessor of the accreditation. That means students from other university will also visit the university to do the assessment. And also, of course, the colleagues, that means the professor or lecturers from other universities. And what the university gives the industry, so internship. So usually company offers like 6 month internship for students, bachelor or master student, the whole semester. And research transfer here means that the research result will be directly also commercialized, also exploited by the industry, and consulting. Of course, at the end is university supplies skilled laborers to the industry. Little bit comparison based on my experience, because I have done a lot of visiting professorships in Indonesia. So this is based on of my observation. So for lecturers, in the recruitment or qualification of lecturer in Indonesia, so usually it's minimum of master degree, but in Germany, to start as a lecturer or to start as a professor, we need to have the doctoral degree with plus qualifications, which are, for example, industrial experiences or postdocs training, postdoctoral trainings, group lead or junior professorships. So it can be done, for example, the industrial experience can be done before the doctoral degrees, for example. And in Indonesia, linearity is important. That means the education of the lecturer should be linear. But in Germany, if the person or the lecturer or the professor has a transdisciplinary background, is the strength. So that means he has a better chance to get the position. And who decide who will be recruit? So in Indonesia, usually some kind of policy makers. It can be governments, it can be like the foundation or the management of university. But in Germany, usually the recruitment to select the candidates of lecturer or professor, it depends on the users, which are, there is usually a selection committee that consists of professors, the colleagues, the people from industries, students, and also from administration staff. So these people are actually the users of, or the ones that will work together with the professors. And as a professor, usually the authority is depend on the rules of the government or the policymaker. But in Germany, so as a professor, we have a freedom of teaching and research. So we can teach anything we like. Usually it's matched to the research topic. And we can do research on anything. And the access to resource like labs and human resource and so on, usually in Indonesia managed by the faculty or study program, but in Germany it's faculty or study program doesn't have any budget. Usually each of professor can manage the resource. And the teaching load for university is around 9 to 10 credits, one semester weekly hours is so called. So it's one SWS is around 45 minutes teaching. So for a University of Applied Science, it's like twice of the university. And then perform evaluations for lecturer in Indonesia. It's usually nationally standardized or standardized by the management. But in Germany, it's based on the agreement. So some of professors, for example, quite strong in teaching, some others strong in research. So that means it accommodates based on the strength of the professors. So, and what is also here in Germany is quite common is the mobility of the career from industry to academia and vice versa. So in Germany, it's encouraged that the academia and industry, I mean, the mobility of career between industry and academia, but in Indonesia, it's usually generally not possible. So this is an example of job descriptions of faculty members in German university or higher education. In our university, for example, we have also position like so-called lecturer and position called professors. So the difference is that the lecturer doesn't have to do research. So the focus is on teaching and the professor has obligation to do research. And the lecturer has a more teaching load than professors. For example, minimum of 15 credits per semester, but professor like only 9 to 10. So this performance evaluation is done by choosing this different path. For example, for lecturer, lecturer can decide whether he want or she want to focus on the inspiration, which is more like giving talks, publication in popular articles, and mentoring students and so on, or focusing on research. If the lecturer wants to focus on inspiration, he or she doesn't have to do research. also in prof, as professor, you can also focus on these different things, different focus on teaching. So that means the load of teaching more than the other activities. And typical professor is like just is like this: 40% teaching, 30% research, and the rest is inspiration and administration. Or focus on research. So 40% research, 20% teaching, and the rest for inspiration and administration. What is common here is that there is a basic load of 20% for administration. So that means all of faculty members need to attend like meetings to be involved in a committee, and also like doing some administration stuff, also doing personal development, for example, to join some or to attend some trainings and so on. But yeah, but the administration load is just maximum of 20%. So I think most of you are lecturers or professors, so I would like to know what activities you spend the most. For what activities do you spend your time the most? Either administration, research, education or teaching, and inspiration, which is so for example social engagement. So it's quite interesting because nobody answer administration. Yeah, only one. Because when I did some visiting professorship, many lecturer said that they have a lot of things to do related to administration. But it seems not the most time that you spent on the administration. All right, it seems that Indonesia is quite a social country. That means community-based country. That means comparing to Germany, that people spend less, quite less for the inspiration and social engagement. Usually people, lecturers or faculty members focus on research and education. So it's quite interesting results. So that I did not expect it. So let's continue with the next topic, which is the roles of the higher education in teaching. So let's go to the next question, which is you give some option here, and what do you think is not the core component in learning process in university, for example? Student, materials, teacher, or technologies. Yeah. So in learning process, teacher, my student, and materials actually the core component. You can see here in the slide. So you can see here the overview of learning process that's also should be applied also in university or in higher education, that there are three components HR students, materials, and lecturer. So this, the effectiveness of the students in learning depends on these two, the lecturers and the materials. So that means the students, the material should be so in the form that it allows easy comprehension by the student. That means the presentation of the material should be good, should build the structure of thinking of the students, and the lecturer should have a good relationship with the students. So that means in some cases we need to have some kind of personal contact with the students, and also understand what the students wants and so on, and the other way. And lecturer should be respected by the students. And in order to be respected, for example, the lecturer should have the good competence on the material, related to the material. So that means the way the lecturer present the materials and understand the materials is also important. So how learning process works, usually students or we collect informations, and then from teaching, from internet, from reading and so on, and process the informations and build some kind of structure of knowledge based on this process information in our brain, and then apply this knowledge. And then from the application of the knowledge, we collect also the experience, the information. So it's like a loop. And the conventional way of learning, in a conventional way of teaching also, is that if we have some materials of books, and the lecturer or the teacher just to show the materials and explain the content of the materials, and just to also even to read out the materials, and the expected outcome of the conventional way of learning is every student has the same content. It's like the same copy of the source of the information, like this. So learning was about storing the information, but the problem is now is that we have because of the internet era, digitalization, and we can easily get information from anything. So what happened is that students can be overloaded with information from books, also from internet and so on. So the modern way of learning is like this. So that, for example, there is some materials, some topics, and the role of teaching of the teacher or lecturer is just to give some support of learning and stimulate student to and motivate them to learn and to do learning, and inspire them on the topics, for example, based on the experience or the way the lecturer communicate or present the material. So it should be inspired, it should inspire the students, and the outcome is that the student construct the information in their mind, and each of the student can have some kind of different perspectives on the same topic. So it's okay. So the learning is about constructing the meaning independently. So we need to transform from teaching oriented to learning oriented. Okay? So for example, learning strategy, which is commonly used by people here, is so-called sandwich. So that means this kind of sandwich is mixed between teacher activities and student activities. So that means first, for example, the lecturers point out what is the context, what is topics, and the students lecture to provide inputs, and the students work on something, reflect the content, and then work on something, and the lecturer give feedbacks and so on. So it's like sandwich. So it can be done through, for example, flipped classroom, where the students are given some materials and they have to present it to the peers, and then we as the lecturer give them some feedbacks and so on. And now let's move to the research. What is the roles of the higher education in research, at least in Germany? So basically in Germany, the funding source of research in a university is from three sources. So the basic funding usually is from the state, from some kind of endowments or from foundations, which provide the funding for the operational of the university. And then for the basic research, yeah, like to maintain the basic research infrastructure and so on. And then from public funding again agency, for example, European Union ministries in Germany, TFG is some kind of research funding or institution owned by the government, and also from third parties, from industry, through research contract. But the different, I think what I'm thinking is slightly different is that the management and development of research, you know, is done by the research group. So for example, I have a research group and the research activities are performed there. And the organization of this research group is independent from the study program. So that means there is no like hierarchy between like the chair of study program, for example, to the professors of the faculty members. So they are the same level, but like the chair of the study program just has some kind of coordination roles only related to study program, related to education. So in research, for example, to be a professor in the university, so you can see here, so in Germany, we have so-called Mittelbau. Mittelbau means some kind of middle level in the organization of university. So these middle level people are the main players in the research. So that means if we want to be a research university, I think we need to have some kind of this main player in research, which are actually the doctoral researchers, yeah, or PhD students, postdoctoral researchers, and senior postdoc, which usually lead some kind of small research group, or junior group leaders or junior professors. Usually they don't have really many teaching obligation. It's just the mainly is research, main activities research. And they can also lead the bachelor and master students to do research. For example, their topics are broken down into like smaller topics, and that can be done by master and bachelor students. And professors more like to give some kind of strategy of the research, and also the orchestration of the research activities that are done by the middle bow here. So usually the career path of professors in a university is typically from here to there. So that means before being a professor, a person usually had some experience as either junior group leaders or junior professor lecturer. And the strategy implementation of research strategy is top down, that the professor developed the strategies, and then the implementation is then top down, and like the front man of the research is this middle level, and the implementer can be bachelor or master students. And how we can guarantee the synergy between research and education? So usually what our research topic, professor's research topics, is broken down into doctoral or postdoctoral research topics, and then also further broken down into undergraduates and postgraduate thesis. So in our case, usually thesis are full-time job. So like usually bachelor's thesis 450 hours full-time. So that means it's like three months full-time. Our master's thesis is 30 credits, like 900 hours full-time or 6 months. So they have they don't have to take some courses usually. When they do thesis, they focus on their thesis or full-time research. And this is also that the advisor of the thesis, for example, is the reviewer. So that means the time of the lecturer or professor are not spent to do some reviewer of the thesis that supervised by someone else, for example, on for master and PhD master and bachelor student. But for PhD, yes, for PhD we need to have to do the review as the reviewer for PhD student who are supervised by other professor, for example. But for bachelor and master student, there's only need the advisor, which is also the reviewer. So we can evaluate the work of the student based on daily interaction, not only the final exam or the final presentations, but also like, for example, here you can see those criteria that are used to evaluate the thesis, bachelor and master thesis. So it's quietly, it cannot be, this information cannot be retrieved in the final exam or presentation. It's just, we can fill this form out if we know the student and we follow the progress of the work of the student. And how to integrate research in education. So what we do usually, because we have a freedom of research and teaching, usually I explain also the research topics in some courses. So because the courses is quite related to my research topic, so the research topics usually can be further development of the course or applications of some topics in the course. And the research topic becomes usually motivation for the course. Usually in the beginning, we explain why the student need to learn this topic in the course and for what kind of research or application that this topic in the course can be applied. And now in transfer. So how the transfer look like? So what we follow in Germany is here transfer means how to transfer the research and also education in the university to the society or industry. So what the model that we follow is the so-called open innovation model. So that if we have want to develop a product or service, first we need to do research, and the research can be developed through some kind of innovation projects and then commercializations and so on. So, but it doesn't have to be done by one organization. So this dashed line means that it's open. So that means any steps of this innovation process from research to market uptake can be done by different organizations. So that's why we need, even in research, we can also cooperate with companies, even in the early phase of innovation, which is here. So, and also startups in our case in my university is quite very supported. So the government has a program called Exist, where the students or PhD students or researchers can apply to. This is some kind of scholarship that they give us some kind of salary every month salary to build our startup if our idea and also the business model makes sense, and we need like time to develop or make the product more mature. So usually we have also some kind of workshop like this in university to as a where the people can work for their startup. And this is, for example, please. Yeah, this is 5 minutes. Yeah, and this some more successful startups. And what also what we have here is the integration of startup program in curriculum. So that means the activities of the student in startup can be counted as credits. Course credits. And also we have also like research project that cooperate with companies like this that I'm working right now. So where the companies can get also funding from the funding agency where the university get funding of 100% of the research cost. But the companies can only get subsidy for the research, 50 to 60% for SME and 30 to 40% for large enterprises. I think I can skip this one. In transport, we have also project specially funded for dissemination of research that already funded by the agencies, like European Union, for example. So the project doesn't have any research content. It's just dissemination of the exploitation and of the research or results. So for example, conducting workshops, conferences, and development of standardizations, and also development of business model, for example. And transformation during the pandemic year, it was quite hard to transform in the short time. Because the teaching in classroom is not possible, so we need a large room to keep the physical distancing. So everything should be transformed into online in a short time. So, but the government support us by giving some grants to the universities. Yeah? For example, for up to 4 million for State Bremen and 20 million for State North Rhine-Westphalia. And what we did in our university is that we form a task force that consists of students, lecturers, IT staffs, and admin staffs to choose the best tools based on different perspectives of, and also to develop some kind of approach how we can apply these tools in a smooth way. So, for example, we use Zoom and Microsoft Teams for webinars, and L Plus and Proofsters for online exam. For example, we have here Proofsters that the student can do exam at home and proctored by camera. And we conduct also training and also develop knowledge base so that all of the people can get updated on the what's going on and also what tools should be used and how they can be used. Can skip it then. So there are some tips to do online learning that we apply in the university. That, for example, what's important here is to make everything work also from a student side, not only from the lecturer side. And also diversification of teaching modes, not only like frontal teaching, but also like integrating quizzes, games, and change mode every 20 minutes. What also we need to do is also to motivate students to spend extra time and to motivate students that everything will be over and so on. And also now we are starting to do hybrid learning. So there's a, I teach, for example, in person in the classroom, and then also activate some a camera so that the student who is still stuck in their countries or cannot travel to Germany, for example, still can attend the lectures. And what's important is that lecturers is also source of inspiration. So that means not only just teaching, but the teacher in this digital era need to be inspiration, that the student can be motivated to learn more, not just to copy what we have, but also to choose the career path that related to the teaching materials. In short, is that something like this in digital areas, in digital era, so that's in conventional learning, just copy like before, and in the modern learning in digital area, so that we can, or the student can get the information from internet, from online online learning, from the online courses, from Coursera and so on, and also from previous or other courses, and then they have to construct it. We need to provide some kind of structure in the mind of the students. So here, the role of the technology is just to improve the experience, not to replace the role of us as lecturer, but to improve the experience of the student in learning process. Like in like reacting to the stimulus, yeah, behaviorism, like using online quiz and so on, and to improve the experience of cognitism. Here, like to help improve the quality of presentation materials using videos and so on, and to help the student to construct the contents, yeah, see mind maps, flipped classroom, and so on. So what we are doing now is a hybrid classroom. We have I teach like this, and then also online version of this, and we need this kit. This is cost around less than 200 euros in total to do hybrid teaching. And also now the last slide is about digital transformation in project, which is related to research and transfers. So same, we do like a video conferencing platform like Microsoft Teams and Skype, for example. And what is important that we have to have now, because we don't have any like in-person meeting, is quite difficult like to track also the progress. So that means we need to have some kind of project management and knowledge management tools like Jira or also Confluence and so on. And of course, to store the information, we need to have set repository and also work in a collaborative document editing software, for example, Overleaf or Google Docs. As a conclusion, here, good teachers cannot be replaced by technologies. And so that means just improve in technologies, improve the experience of the students. And we need to focus on the learning objectives, not the which technology that you use. We need to then choose the technologies that suit the learning objectives. Yeah, and technology developed in a direction that is easy to operate. So that means don't be afraid to learn new technologies, because it's getting more easy and easy for human to operate the technologies. We need to just focus on the learning goals. Okay, thank you for the listening my share. So if you have questions, please, then I would like to be glad to answer them. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Prof. Hendro. Okay, we continue to discussion session. For the first opportunity, please, Dr. Fal Sadikin,
to answer the question from chat. And if you have for the all participant, if you have a question, you can use oral or chat. Please, Dr. Fal Sadikin.
Okay, thank you very much. I got several interesting questions today. So starting first from Habil. So what is the question here? So I would like to ask question to Mr. Fal Sadikin. If I work at big company like Amazon, for example, I founded some patent. So who own the patent actually? Me or company? Okay, so maybe it is better if Habil can show up and speak directly to me. I mean, it is fine, I guess, to use just Indonesian language to ask the question, right? For is that true?
Hello, Habil.
Ya, Pak. Halo, Pak.
Ya, silakan.
Boleh, silakan.
Ya, Pak. Saya agak kebingungan ketika kita menemukan paten, tapi di saat yang sama kita bekerja di suatu perusahaan yang besar gitu seperti Amazon. Nah, ketika kita menemukan paten tersebut dan kita mendaftarkannya, itu yang mempunyai paten itu adalah kita atau perusahaan kita, Pak. Seperti itu. Kemudian yang mendapatkan umpan balik atau revenue atau uang katakan dari paten tersebut, kita ataukah perusahaan tersebut? Terima kasih, Pak.
Yeah, so thank you. That's very interesting question, the good one. So basically, the right question for us is depends on the contract between you and the company. So I don't know what happened in Amazon, but what happened in Philips right now, like Signify, where the company I work, we have kind of contract where the inventor still get a recognition. For example, in the draft of patent itself, the inventor will be listed as the inventor there, but we also get money in the registration, like some kind of sum of money. But actually, the patent is owned by the company. That's the case in Philips Lighting mostly. And then we still get money, but the rest of the profit will take care by the company. I hope that's clear. Is that clear for you?
Thank you, Mr. Fal Sadikin.
Ya, jadi itu sebenarnya tergantung kontraknya ya. Jadi kalau kontraknya, taruhlah Anda pemilik startup, sudah tentu paten itu milik Anda sendiri. Tapi kalau memang saya kebetulan kontraknya itu dengan Philips, itu apapun yang saya temukan, itu akan dimiliki oleh perusahaan. Jadi patennya, profitnya, kemudian copyright-nya itu milik perusahaan. Tapi tetap saja kami diberi benefit dari situ. Jadi setiap kali kami mendaftarkan paten satu penemuan itu kami diberi ya revenue dari situ. Cuman di saat pendaftaran ya tidak sisanya itu dihandle oleh perusahaan. Jelas ya?
Baik, terima kasih Pak.
Kalau nggak salah ada pertanyaan lagi dari Habil. Dua pertanyaan kalau nggak salah ya.
Untuk yang selanjutnya itu mau minta ini Pak. Presentation materialnya aja. Boleh
oh ya, nanti saya share. Ya.
Oke, baik. Oh, ya. Terima kasih, Pak.
Oke, kemudian ada satu lagi pertanyaan dari Rudy ya. Bertanya tentang, jadi apakah seorang akademik itu punya hambatan ya untuk mungkin bisa show up, Rudy, biar bisa lebih.
Ya, halo. Halo.
Ya.
Assalamualaikum.
Waalaikumsalam.
Oh, bahasa Indonesia atau bahasa Inggris nih? Sama aja.
Ya, terserah. Sama aja.
Oke. Okay. Oh, sebenarnya ada dua pertanyaan, tapi mungkin saya langsung gabungkan aja ya.
Ya.
Tadi yang pertama itu memang benar terkait dengan fasilitas, karena sebenarnya kalau mungkin di Eropa kan untuk baik di universitas maupun di perusahaan kan pasti disupport. Nah, sementara kalau kami kan di Indonesia itu kan keterbatasan mungkin dari segi cost maupun dari segi apa fasilitasnya. Karena kalau saya lihat penemuan dari Mas Fal Sadikin kan pasti itu cost-nya besar-besar ya kalau saya lihat ya dari sisi ininya ya, alat-alatnya dan tools-nya atau lain-lain lah. Nah, itu yang pertama. Untuk yang kedua terkait dari sisi mengkombinasikan sebenarnya yang karena kalau kita lihat dari Mas ini kan saya lihat dari background-nya memang sebenarnya lebih ke underground ya, artinya lebih ke teknikal, lebih ke praktisi gitu ya. Nah, ini gimana nih kalau misalnya apakah memang terhambat ya kalau kalau kita di universitas itu sepertinya kurang bebas atau bagaimana kita mau seperti Mas Fasaldikin di mana mampu mengkombinasikan benar-benar lebih lebih bebas gitu, lebih lebih apa ya istilahnya? Penemuan-penemuan itu yang memang lebih ke praktikal itu kita bisa bawa ke universitas gitu. Bisa diterima nggak yang kedua ini, Mas?
Ya, ya. Oke, saya mulai dari yang yang pertama ya. Mungkin baiknya saya share the screen.
Boleh, boleh.
Ya, mungkin seperti yang saya sudah sebutkan tadi, bisa lihat screen saya sekarang?
Oke.
Harus bahasa Inggris nggak ini? Jadi, mulai tadi dari apa tadi pertanyaannya? Tentang labor work ya. Jadi ada mitos. Jadi kembali kita bahas tadi, maaf mungkin terlalu jauh. Ada beberapa mitos di paten itu ya. Pertama itu tentang bahwa seorang harus jenius ya untuk bisa menemukan menghasilkan paten. Sebenarnya tidak sepenuhnya benar. Jadi ada beberapa paten itu sebenarnya bahkan tidak memerlukan eksperimen yang panjang. Mungkin Anda lihat di screen saya sekarang ada satu paten yang sangat terkenal yang jadi yang menjadi breakthrough sebenarnya, padahal sebenarnya ini bukan betul-betul breakthrough. Ini cuma ide sederhana tentang one click paten tadi. Jadi ketika seseorang mengunjungi online service, belanja online, dia hanya butuh melakukan satu klik untuk bisa melakukan belanja ya. They need to visit, they need to just do one click to do the online purchasing, which means that you don't have really to do the big work here, labor work. And there are so many patent right now in the patent office. If you can check, actually some of them even it is just idea. As long as you can prove it, it's gonna work. That and then the expert in the patent office know that it should work. Then you can patent that one because some of patent is just about idea. Of course, if you talk about Nikola Tesla or Thomas Alva Edison, when they try to find out the breakthrough of technology, you need a lot of labor work on that. You need to spend most of the time. But I can prove that. Like for example here. Maybe you can find something like, for example, to automatically fix the problem on the building by using drone technology, which means that you can prove that without using labor work. We don't have to use experiment. You just need to prove that we already have machine learning technology. We have already robotic technology. You can explain in conceptual, and then you submit your idea, and then the people in patent office will think that this idea should work, and then this is good idea, and then they can reward you. As long as you can conceptually you can prove it. What I want to say here, not every patent need big work in labor work. So you don't really need to cost. Like for example, one click Amazon, you don't need to prove it. You just give your idea. What happened there? Oh yeah, the online portal already store all your information, your address, your credit card number, and so on. So you just need to prove it that that's possible in storing in data of the online service, and then you just need one click. So I think. So that's what I mean. That's not every patent needs a big work. You just need to submit your idea that can be breakthrough for the society. And then the second question is about the university. I don't remember. What was the question?
Kombinasi between practical and
academic. Yes. So. This is the things that you have to keep in mind here. Actually, university is not the place to implement something. University is the place you learn of conceptual things. So if you want to be an expert, you need to find the community. Like let's say you want to be a hacker, the things that you can do is you find the community, like Black Hat, Red Hat, and so on. Then you can learn from them. So university basically the way to you learn about the concept. Maybe you get the idea. So if you want to be really expert, you need to do it by yourself. Of course, the teacher in the university, we can help you. They can teach you how you do the certain of technique. They can give you good concept of why you can do that. Like for example, yeah. What I want to say actually, yeah, say if you want to be really expert, you need to try by yourself. You need to learn certain things practically. Is that answer your question?
Yes. But if you research a new technology, you have to or tools or device I think very apa lebih mahal ya. Kayak penelitian Mas Wal Sadikin saya lihat ada beberapa kan yang memang sepertinya teknologi-teknologi baru ya. Itu kalau kami kan mungkin hanya nah itu kira-kira gimana itu?
Yeah, that's very challenging, but I think yes. Right now government already provide some of funding. Maybe we can try to propose the to the government or to the university. Yeah, that's difficult when you have very limited funding. But again, if you think about to be an expert first, you need to try by yourself for sure.
Okay.
But of course, you need to also helping from the lecturer and from the university because they are very expert. They have expertise in certain area. But again, because the most important thing is you need to try by yourself if you want to work in technology.
Okay. Thank you. I get it.
Yeah. And then I got also. Saya juga ada beberapa pertanyaan lain kalau nggak salah ya. Chatnya mana ya? Ada yang lain nggak?
There is question from Feby Eka to Dr. Yeah.
Feby.
Di atas.
Halo Feby.
Halo Pak.
Ya, halo.
Iya.
Kecilan.
My question is how do you get a patent for a company that
originally kamera on baby.
Open your video.
Kamera on.
Oke, bahasa Indonesia aja mungkin. Ya.
Pertanyaannya yaitu bagaimana jika suatu produk yang kita buat itu memiliki karakteristik yang sama dengan produk yang lain. Nah, untuk mendapatkan paten yang sesuai dengan produk kita, apakah ada kriteria untuk mendaftarkan produk kita ke paten yang sesuai, Pak?
Misal jadi
contohnya ada produk Oreo dan Curio-Rio. Nah, itu kan memiliki karakteristik yang sama. Apakah ada syarat untuk kebutuhan mendaftarkan paten untuk produk kita? Terima kasih, Pak.
Ya, jadi dalam paten itu ada istilah namanya infringement. Jadi kita cek. Jadi paten itu sebenarnya big business ya. Kita tetap butuh bantuan dari jadi mungkin contohnya misalkan di Philips ya. Jadi ada satu departemen yang khusus menangani tentang paten. Mereka ini tugasnya banyak. Ada yang memang tugasnya untuk menjudge. Jadi preliminary judge tentang ide-ide yang kita kumpulkan. Tapi ada juga yang sifatnya mereka ini tugasnya untuk melihat produk-produk apa yang sudah ada di launching di masyarakat. Mungkin contohnya ketika ada lampu baru misalkan di launching oleh perusahaan lain, kita coba ambil lampu itu, kita ambil, kemudian ada satu orang di IP department yang unpackage lampu itu, kemudian teknologi itu, mereka melihat apakah di sana ada LED. Misalkan contohnya, atau misalkan LED yang mereka pakai itu sesuai dengan paten yang kita punya, tapi mereka tidak bayar ke kita. Misalkan seperti itu. Jadi ada pihak-pihak memang yang coba mengecek ya, they try to check whether it is infringed or technology, and they need to pay for us. Is that answer your question? Mas Feby Eka.
Halo Mas Feby.
Jadi misalkan kalau kita ingin melakukan paten, biasanya itu kita dibantu. Kalau di Philips ya, kita sudah dibantu. Saya kumpulkan ide itu ke departemen IP department. Nah, orang-orang IP department ini akan melakukan judge, preliminary judge. Mereka lihat oh secara konsep bisa. Kemudian saya tunjukkan demonya, saya buktikan saya bisa, saya konsep ini mungkin bisa dipatenkan. Saya tunjukkan bekerja. Kemudian setelah itu mereka mengecek. Biasanya mereka spending waktu 6 bulan untuk melihat produk-produk apa saja yang sudah pernah ada di pasaran, apa-apa saja yang sudah dipatenkan, apakah ini sama dengan paten yang sudah ada sebelumnya. Jadi memang salah satu syarat paten itu harus betul-betul novel ya, betul-betul sesuatu yang baru yang belum pernah dipatenkan sebelumnya. Kurang lebihnya seperti itu. bisa terjawab pertanyaannya?
Bisa, Pak. Terima kasih, Pak.
Ya. Kemudian ada lagi kalau nggak salah. Saya agak sulit mencari. Ya, kemudian ada satu pertanyaan dari Rizky Fridi.
Iya, Pak.
Oh, iya. Gimana tadi pertanyaan?
Jadi, saya ingin bertanya, Pak. Misalnya kita mendaftarkan paten di Indonesia dan dipakai di pabrik di sini, misalnya kayak seperti Nike atau Unilever, yang memiliki pabrik di luar negeri juga. Nah, tapi ternyata paten kita juga dipakai untuk diproduksi di luar negeri. Apakah saya mendapatkan benefit atau profit dari yang diproduksi di Indonesia saja atau juga dari luar negeri? Terima kasih.
Oke, ini juga pertanyaan yang bagus. Seperti yang sudah saya jelaskan tadi, bahwa ada limitation di paten itu. Ada dua limitation. Yang pertama limitation dengan time. Jadi ketika kita mematenkan sesuatu, itu granted, itu ada waktunya, ada usianya. Usianya itu adalah 20 tahun. Artinya apa? Teknologi yang kita temukan itu setelah 20 tahun, itu nantinya boleh dipakai orang. Boleh dipakai orang tanpa izin dari kita, as long as itu sudah 20 tahun dari usia granted-nya ya. Kemudian limitation kedua itu teritori. Jadi misalkan kalau saya meregistrasi ide saya di taruhlah di Uni Eropa, jadi European Patent Office. Jadi artinya aturan ini saya punya right untuk hak untuk melakukan manufaktur, hak untuk melakukan distribusi, kemudian hak untuk melakukan penjualan di wilayah Uni Eropa. Jadi ketika ada orang di dua wilayah ini, taruhlah misalkan di Rusia, dia melakukan manufaktur ide yang sama, kita tidak bisa melakukan infringement, kita tidak bisa menuntut mereka. Itu sebabnya ketika kita mempunyai invensi, ketika taruhlah yang terjadi di Signify, ketika kita punya ide, kita patenkan, itu biasanya kita tidak cuma patenkan di Uni Eropa, kita patenkan juga di wilayah Amerika, kita patenkan ke Jepang, India, Cina dan beberapa negara-negara yang potensial menjadi mengcopy teknologi kita. Kurang lebihnya seperti itu. Jadi itu limitasi dari paten ya. Jadi seperti saya bilang tadi, time and territory. Jadi kurang lebih seperti itu. Jadi kalau misalkan Anda menemukan paten, Anda cuma registrasi di Indonesia, kemudian ada orang Eropa melihat, oh ternyata ini belum diregistrasi di Eropa. Orang Eropa bisa memproduksi itu. Perusahaan di Eropa bisa memproduksi itu. Dan menjualnya dan tentu saja mendistribusikan.
Oke, okay, I get you, sir. Thank you. Ya.
Ada pertanyaan lain?
Any question, please?
Sebentar. Ada. Mungkin ada lagi tadi, kalau nggak salah. Cuman saya agak gimana ini? Ya, ada pertanyaan untuk Profesor Hendro, satu. Kemudian dari... Ya, ada beberapa untuk Profesor Hendro.
Arvan, masih ada waktu untuk Pak Oval?
Iya.
Iya. Pak Oval,
ya.
jam 2 off, Pak? Atau masih bisa...
Kalau masih ada waktu, saya mau bertanya satu.
One shot. Oh iya, silakan.
Silakan.
Yeah. Thank you, Arvan. Thank you, Dr. Fall, for your explanation about patent. It's very, very interesting. Maybe one short question from me. You have talked about the big company in the world who can still run their company in this pandemic area because of the passive income from patents. But how about small medium company, maybe? Is there any chance by those company to have such a passive income as well? Or so sorry. Or maybe patent, way to patents, and how to do patents as well as the big company, how to do that in small medium company. Is that possible? Thank you.
Yeah, so that's also a good question. So basically, there is no requirement for registering the patent. There is no requirement if it is coming from big company. Anyone can do patent, either personally, university, even small company. If you see on the top 100 rank of the company on patent, maybe you can see here that here on the skin, actually not every of them are big company. I think there is something like in the rank like 100 that it is kind of still middle company, not really big. Like you can see Uber maybe it's become bigger right now, but it's not as bigger as Samsung or as bigger as Philips. But you can see also like company like us, maybe you can see here Signify, after splitting out, actually the employee of Signify is just something like 4,000 people employee. It's not we are not so big, but we still have patent there. What I want to say here actually, to be able to patent, if you have an idea, you don't have to be a big company. Every company can do that. Actually, there is no requirement to be a big company to have the patent. So which means that every company, even the small one, even personal, can have the patent. So is that answer the question? Because sometimes I get confused to understand a question from other people.
Yeah, that's answer my question. But then how to starting doing the patent, what preparation or what should this small or very small size of company have to prepare to do the patent?
So of course, patent is big work. But the easiest way, actually, you can find third party company like patent lawyer. You know, a patent lawyer, maybe I cannot still find in Indonesia, but actually become a patent lawyer. Yes, the third party, you can just submit your idea. But please bear in mind that you need to find the trusted third party, because sometimes they just copy your idea and then they submit somewhere else. So you need to find the third party. You submit your idea, they can give you requirement, and then they can help you to draft the patent. The patent, like what is the invention that you have, and then they submit. They help you to submit to the appropriate patent office, either you want to submit to Europe, US, or something else. So the easiest way, try to find the third party that can help you. It's something like it is big business indeed. So maybe this is also good information for the student in Indonesia. Actually, one of the interesting job with that can get a lot of money in US is becoming a patent lawyer. Where you can help people to judge their invention, and then you can help them to draft their invention in patent language, because you know that sometimes if you read the patent draft, the language is very low language. It is not technical. Sometimes even people like me who is the inventor, sometimes I try to draft in technical way, and then they translate it to the low language, which is sometimes I don't really understand what they mean. If you learn, it is just about claiming. So the easiest way, you can find a third party who can help you to deal with the patent.
Okay, thank you.
But maybe one more thing, but actually maybe the good idea also for the university, because you know that Larry Page, what I mentioned, he registered the patent, he tried to fill the patent when he was a student, because it is possible for him to do that, because let me jump to the last slide that I forgot to show. You know, like University of Stanford, they have their own department there, patent department, which means that this is also maybe the Diponegoro University should think about maybe in the future, that you should have the patent office that help the student to submit their idea there, then supervise them, helping them to what to do with to submit the patent. Then you should have good relationship with the patent office. If you cannot find in Indonesia, you can try to make the relationship to the patent office in US or in Europe. So that's the things that you should think about. I think it is also good, very good achievement for Diponegoro University if they have also the patent office. So maybe another university they have invested, they can come up to you to help them to patenting their idea or invention. So yeah, that's all for me.
Yeah. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. So see you for the, I have to leave because I have meeting very soon. So thank you very much for your attention and opportunity to share the idea. So thank I you. Hope we can meet
thank
again.
Thank you very much, Dr. Falsad again.
So take picture together for
okay, yeah.
One time.
Sure. Yeah. Please camera on.
Could you please unshare the screen, Dr. Fal?
Oh yes.
I can get more wide screen.
Okay.
Thank you. Okay, 1, 2, 3. Okay, 1, 2, 3. Okay, 1, 2, 3. Thank you very much.
Yeah, you can patent the idea, taking the picture 3 times. Okay, see you.
Okay, thank you.
Bye. See you, Professor Hendro. Nice to meet you.
Yeah, nice to meet you too.
Thank you very much, Dr. Paul Sadikin.
Bye.
Okay, sebelum Profesor Hendro menjawab pertanyaan, ada pesan sponsor, saya sedikit presentasi mengenai program S2 Teknik dan Manajemen Industri. Okay. Moment please. Baik, kami sudah membagikan brosur atau flyer untuk S2 Teknik dan Manajemen Industri. Saya akan sedikit jelaskan bagaimana kurikulum program S2 Teknik dan Manajemen Industri. Kemudian hal-hal teknis yang lain yang mungkin bisa membantu Bapak-Ibu yang hadir di sini barangkali berminat untuk sekolah di tempat kami. Baik, jadi di tempat kami di S2 Teknik dan Manajemen Industri ada 3 model ya proses pembelajaran. Yang pertama adalah by course, kemudian yang kedua adalah by research, ya. Kemudian model yang ketiga adalah fast track. Jadi kalau fast track pada prinsipnya sama dengan by research. Nah, yang kami tampilkan di sini adalah struktur kurikulum untuk by course, ya. Walaupun ada tetap ada penelitian di struktur kurikulum by course-nya. Ya. Jadi kita ada 3 semester, jadi program kami lebih cepat, ya. Jadi 3 semester diharapkan mahasiswa S2 bisa menyelesaikan studinya. Ya. Ini adalah kurikulumnya. Ada 36 SKS yang harus diambil, ya, dari statistik lanjut sampai ke tesis. Kemudian untuk persyaratan masuk ke tempat kami, pada prinsipnya mahasiswa teknik industri, ya, kemudian non teknik industri bisa, ya, dari engineering, dari science atau dari ekonomi manajemen. Bisa mengikuti kuliah di tempat kami. Untuk yang dari non-teknik industri, biasanya nanti akan mendapatkan kuliah matrikulasi. Ada 4 mata kuliah untuk matrikulasi. Yang pertama adalah kuantitatif, kemudian PPIC, human factor, dan cost analysis. Baik. Oke. Okay. Untuk pengajar di tempat kami, kami sudah memiliki 14 dosen, yang satu sudah bergelar profesor, Profesor Dr. Aris Susanti, dan memiliki banyak pengalaman di bidangnya masing-masing. Nah, kami ada 5 konsentrasi, ya, konsentrasi yang bisa diambil atau ditekuni selama mengikuti studi di tempat kami. Yang pertama adalah supply chain, ya. And logistik, sebagai manajemen logistik, kemudian ada rekayasa sistem manufaktur dan kualitas, kemudian ada e-business, kemudian ada manajemen rekayasa, kemudian yang terakhir adalah human factor and safety. Jadi itu untuk profil kurikulum dan pengajar. Kemudian untuk jadwal penting atau tanggal penting yang bisa diperhatikan dalam proses pendaftaran, untuk gelombang 1 tahun 2020 ini untuk semester genap, dari tanggal 1 sampai 7 November 2020, kemudian ujian tesnya tanggal 22 November, dan pengumuman kelulusannya 4 Desember. Saya lihat di database pendaftar sudah cukup banyak. Ya, mudah-mudahan peserta webinar ini ada yang berminat. Ya, silakan kalau ada pertanyaan bisa tanya ke saya. Ya, di flyer yang saya share di chat ada nomor HP yang bisa dihubungi. Kemudian syarat bisa dilihat juga di flyer. Ya. Kemudian biaya juga bisa dilihat di flyer. Baik, terima kasih untuk kesempatan menjelaskan atau presentasi tentang program S2 Teknik dan Manajemen Industri. Oke, let's continue Profesor Hendro. Halo, Profesor Hendro.
Oh ya, yeah, Pak.
Oke, please, you can give answer for the questions.
Okay. Should I give in Indonesian or English?
Up to you. Up to you.
Okay, I think most of you are Indonesian, so in order to that, you can also ask. It's more comfortable that you can ask in also in Indonesian. So mungkin saya switch ke bahasa Indonesia. Untuk pertanyaan dari Prof. Aris, masalahnya. Prof. Aris. Prof. Aris Susanti tentang do your university have the program of student exchange or lecturer exchange or postdoctoral visit? How apply it? Any scholarship for your university? Jadi kalau di sini memungkinkan memang melakukan student exchange, tapi memang programnya harus sinkron. Jadi memang saat ini kita baru exchange student dengan S1, S2 dengan universitas-universitas tertentu yang benar-benar kontennya itu sama, mirip gitulah, sinkron. Ya. Terus kemudian, tapi ada kemungkinan juga untuk melakukan student exchange dengan universitas tertentu yang kurikulumnya tidak terlalu sinkron, asal mahasiswanya itu banyak yang ikut. Misalnya lebih dari 30 atau lebih dari 20. Gitu. Itu bisa dibuatkan semacam spesial student exchange. Untuk lecturer exchange dan postdoctoral visit atau student exchange untuk S3 itu lebih simpel. Itu bisa kapan saja sebenarnya. Dengan prosedurnya cukup apply-nya ke pembimbing atau profesor yang bidangnya itu dituju gitu ya. Tapi sekarang permasalahannya tentang funding. Nah, ini ada pertanyaan dengan scholarship. Secara umum dari universitasnya sendiri tidak ada scholarship. Jadi memang scholarship itu, definisi scholarship ini saya mengertinya dengan tema yang dibawa sendiri, ya, kemudian mendapatkan funding atau beasiswa dari universitas itu biasanya nggak ada. Tapi ada misalnya project, misalnya seorang profesor itu punya project dan butuh misalnya asisten atau orang yang mengerjakan project itu, bisa levelnya postdoc atau levelnya mahasiswa S3 atau PhD student, itu memungkinkan. Tapi ya temanya akhirnya tidak fleksibel, ya tergantung dengan tema yang dapat grant itu, yang profesor dapat grant itu. Jadi biasanya kalau misalnya tema dibawa sendiri, dan kalau supaya fleksibel itu biasanya mencari beasiswa dari luar, contohnya dari DAD atau dari pemerintah negara bagian. Di beberapa negara bagian itu ada pemerintahnya. Terus ataupun dari source dari Indonesia. Karena kalau misalnya project based itu biasanya temanya itu spesifik dan waktunya itu juga nggak fleksibel. Jadi nggak bisa misalnya mulai kapan aja nggak bisa. Jadi project karena ada waktu startnya dan finishnya. Dan itu juga nggak bisa ditawar-tawar gitu. Mungkin itu. Terus pertanyaan yang berikutnya tentang konsep Wissenschaftliche Mitarbeiter di Jerman, apakah bisa diimplementasikan di Indonesia? Jadi Wissenschaftliche Mitarbeiter di Jerman itu, kalau bahasa Inggrisnya Research Associate atau Research Assistant. Jadi kenapa ada konsep research assistant atau research associate di Jerman, karena memang kita sebagai faculty member, ya, sebagai dosen atau profesor itu tidak bisa mendapatkan dana lebih untuk top up misalnya gaji kita gitu. Jadi yang grant itu sebenarnya dipakai untuk meng-hire orang untuk membantu kita sebagai dalam riset. Dan untuk meng-hire orang itu grant itu just kalau di sini mayoritas digunakan untuk membangun kapasitas SDM. Jadi kalau kita dapat grant research itu ya mayoritas dipakai untuk gaji orang. Nah kalau misalnya kita ternyata di proposal risetnya itu ongkos peralatan atau kos peralatan lebih tinggi atau lebih dari 16% dari total budget project keseluruhan, jadi komponen peralatan dominan, itu justru kita perlu menjustifikasi kenapa seperti itu. Jadi memang standarnya grant research itu dipakai untuk pembiayaan SDM. Nah, bentuknya semacam pakai Wissenschaftlicher Mitarbeiter itu atau research associate yang penggajiannya dan kemudian tarif atau tarif gajinya itu sudah standar secara nasional dan per negara bagian gitu ya. Ya itu mungkin kalau konsep di Indonesia ya tanpa adanya legalitas dari atau entah kementerian atau pihak kampus itu agak susah. Jadi yang saya tahu memang konsepnya sudah mirip, memang ada asisten ya di Indonesia. Tapi asisten itu sepertinya yang saya tahu itu tidak ada standarnya, standar secara pengajian dan kemudian hak dan kewajibannya gitu. Dan asisten itu biasanya mungkin nggak bisa dikombinasikan dengan kegiatan S3 gitu. Misalnya kalau di sini Wissenschaftlicher Mitarbeiter atau research associate atau research assistant itu sekaligus dia bisa mengerjakan tesis S3-nya dengan mendapatkan funding dari proyek riset grant itu yang biasanya diakuisisi oleh profesor atau dosen gitu.
Kalau di sana ada model per jam ya, berapa jam, misalkan seminggu, berapa jam ya Prof. Hendro ya?
Iya.
Misalkan 16 jam gitu, nanti tergantung.
Ya. Jadi misalnya gini, kita apply grant sebagai profesor gitu, apply grant untuk nanti meng-hire atau untuk mengerjakan proyek itu ya, suatu proyek yang kita apply itu, kita butuh misalnya 54 bulan per month, 54 orang bulan gitu ya, per month lah gitu ya. Karena di list kerjaannya gini, terus untuk menyelesaikan itu butuh jadi 54 per month. Nah, itu bisa di manage dengan cara misalnya untuk 3 tahun ya, itu misalnya 3 tahun. Jadi 36 bulan nanti 36 PM per month itu untuk posisi full time Wissenschaftlicher Mitarbeiter atau full time assistant, jadi 40 jam. Terus yang 18, nah, yang tadi 54 ya, 36, 14, 18. 18 itu untuk meng-hire yang misalnya part time yang 50%, jadi cuma kerja 20 jam per minggu. Atau bisa didistribusikan 75%, 75%. Jadi tadi 54 jadi 27. Jadi masing-masing rekrut dua orang masing-masing kerja 30 jam atau kontraknya 75%. Nah, jadi biasanya basisnya memang effort untuk mengerjakan project itu untuk berapa orang per month, kemudian cara kita merekrutnya Wissenschaftlicher Mitarbeiter atau merekrut research associate assistant itu tergantung dengan strategi kita, atau bisa meng-hire dua orang dengan kontrak 150 sama 50 atau meng-hire dua orang dengan kontrak 75% misalnya. Ya, jadi kontrak kerja 50%, 75%, 100% itu tergantung dengan strategi di profesornya itu nanti untuk menyelesaikan kerjaan di riset itu. Mungkin itu. Terusnya ada pertanyaan dari Bu Endang Setiarini tentang how funding is obtained for educational research program carried out in Germany. Jadi maksudnya funding untuk research di bidang pendidikan ya, di bidang misalnya pedagogi gitu ya kayaknya. Maksudnya. Bila prinsipnya sama. Jadi kalau kita punya ide research, terus kemudian kita buat proposal termasuk effortnya berapa, costnya berapa, terus work package-nya apa aja, terus peralatan dibutuhkan berapa, terus waktunya berapa, itu tinggal ya apply ke funding agensinya, bisa di level Uni Eropa atau di level Jerman, kementerian di Jerman, terus kemudian ya, kalau dapat grant itu kan kompetitif, jadi nggak selalu dapat kan kalau apply. Kalau dapat grant ya implementasinya sama, jadi misalnya kita apply-nya effortnya tadi untuk 54 person month dalam waktu 3 tahun ya terserah nanti implement distribusinya seperti apa, misalnya 75% atau 54 itu kan sebenarnya ini kan 150% lah gitu ya, 150% posisi untuk 3 tahun. Jadi pembagiannya bisa 100 sama 50 atau 75-75 gitu. Dan itu di yang menentukan ya profesornya yang dapat grant itu atau yang disebut dengan PI atau Principal Investigator. Mungkin gitu atau mungkin kurang ada yang perlu ada kurang jelas untuk bertanya untuk jawaban-jawaban yang tadi itu. Atau ada pertanyaan lain?
Prof. Eno, may I have a question about the project of your the professor in your university. How we know about the project of the professor? The professor give like maybe announcement that they have project and they try to find someone to help him or her. And how we as the lecturer in our university or maybe our student can know about that?
Yeah. Usually if a professor want to get help to help him or her to work on a funded project that got funded, usually he or she publish a job advertisement on the homepage of the university or on the portal like academics.de or some other job portals, and then you can see the specifications there, and then whether it's a similar to applying a job actually. So you need to match your profile with the specification that's published by the professor. So that's why it's not flexible, because usually it's quite specific what are asked there. So if you want to be flexible, then I think it's better to apply some kind of scholarship from DAD or Humboldt. Humboldt is quite a good program for postdocs and senior or lecturers, yes, which already have PhD. So I think if you want to be flexible to start whenever you want, and also topics also flexible, then I think it's better to apply PhD or Humboldt. Because it can happen that that the positions of that advertised by the professor is, for example, is not about research, for example. So the content is more like solving practical parts of the project in the research, for example. So you may end up with, for example, if you pursue PhD, but you may end up with not getting PhD. So it's quite often. So for example, if you want to get PhD in Germany using that scheme, so with
Wissenschaftliche Mitarbeiter. The average duration of your study, I mean your work, is around 6 years. But if you have scholarship, is you can be finished. You can finish in 3 or 4 years.
Yeah. We in Indonesia we have SAME program, a SAME program. Maybe it can be used to exchange the lecture or postdoc program. This year, SAME program with France University. I don't know, maybe next year, maybe with German University, and we'd like to ask you to join with us.
Yeah, of course. So I'm quite open for collaboration in research or research visits or even postdoctoral and doctoral degrees. For postdoctoral and doctoral degrees, I think it's better to use external funding like GED and so and
yes.
Humboldt, so you can have a most flexibility to work on your own topic. Yeah, your own topic. So for example, I have right now 3 or 4 PhD students who work on their own topic, which is actually they are from Indonesia, and topics we agree that this topic should somehow give benefits to the PhD candidates if they return back to Indonesia. So that means it's also give more beneficial for the future of the candidate if the topic can be flexible.
Okay. Thank you.
Mm-hmm. Any other questions, maybe?
Hello, any question, please?
Yeah. Pak Arfan, yeah. I have two questions.
Sure. Too many.
Yeah. Prof. Hendro, thank you very much for the for your presentation about what happens in the Germany that and also that we can learn so much from it. There's two questions from me. One is the startup for students that can become credits. This is very interesting, and I don't think this kind of model already in Indonesia, or I don't know whether this is already here or not. Do you think Indonesia can apply this kind of model that we can give credits to students that can make a startup, like really startup, not only a proposal, business proposal, but really build the startup, and then they can run startup. And if we can do something like this, do you think it should be connected with the lecturer research grant maybe, or something else that we already have here in Indonesia, or where should we start? That's first question from me. I think that question for now. Maybe later, if there's still time, I can answer. I can ask another question. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you, Bumanik. It's this is actually based on the objective of learning of the student in the university. That's the output is that they need to have some kind of idea that can be implemented as startup or to work in companies and so on. And that we counted the startup activities as a credit. It's not just the student has idea and then just doing some random things and then they got credit, not like that, but they need to write something. So to write something like a paper, for example, and that's related to the startups, and they have to ask the lecturers or professor who supervise who is responsible for like a course that related to the startup activities. For example, I had a student who has a startup in sharing economy, mm-hmm. and I teach Industry 4.0 technologies, for example. And the students can replace the course Industry 4.0 technology with their startup activities, but they have to present, they have to write some papers and present the startup activities to me. And then I give him the grades. So I think it's not necessary to be connected to or related to some kind of grants, but we need to accommodate the different way of learning of students from startup. And also I also had a visiting lecture, visiting professorship in ITS last year. So they, in the vocational education faculty, and for example, ITS had quite a good performance, the student of ITS got good performance in extracurricular activities like buildings, fuel efficient cars, for example, building robots and so on. And those activities also can be counted as credits. So I don't know whether they already implemented it, but this is also the source or the way that the student learning in their field. So the problem is, for example, in ITS, that the student who are involved in those competitions of energy efficiency cars, for example, their grades is quite low because most of their time are spent for learning and implementing the energy efficient or fuel efficient cars, for example. So that's why I need to facilitate that. So this is the way, one way of learning, and then we need to accommodate as part of a university program. So I think it's not necessary to be connected to research grant or something, but it need to be connected to the time that's spent by the students for the activities that are relevant for the education.
Yeah, thank you very much.
Yeah.
Okay, thank you very much for Professor Andrew and for the all participants today. Don't forget next webinar in 2 November next month. And I think enough for Mr. Novi.
Yes.
Okay. Uh, 15:39. It's okay. Okay. Thank you very much for our participants. See you next time. Assalamualaikum.
Waalaikumsalam.
Waalaikumsalam. So this webinar is also streamed in the YouTube, so you can also repeat the recording of this webinar in YouTube also. Thank you very much, Prof. Hendro, for joining us and share your experience as well as your knowledge. Thank you for the participants. See you on the next webinar.
Thank you for your time and opportunities, and see you next time.
See you.
Okay. Thank you,
Rabindra. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. For your time.
Thank you.
No photo
session.
No photo session, Punomi.
Sudah.
Ready done.
You have photo session before.
Okay, mau foto lagi? Mari kita foto lagi. Okay, we can take picture one more time. Please.
Tunggu dulu. 1 menit.
Okay, I will wait until 10 seconds.
Kamera on.
Kamera on, please.
10 seconds.
Okay, 10. Okay, we will start the...
Gracia, Tony, Isra, Ahyar, Dani, Yulianta, Ayudila.
Ega, mana Ega? Okay, first slide. 1, 2, 3. Okay, one more time. 1, 2, 3. Okay, the next slide is...
Yes.
Okay, so... Yeah, so this is the end of the webinar. Thank you, and see you next time.
Thank you. See you next time. Assalamualaikum.
Waalaikumsalam.
Waalaikumsalam.
Warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Mbak Afina, Hasya. Halo.
Manik, for tomorrow you have to ask Mr. Singgi.
Yeah. I have
double job, susah.
Triple belum, profesor itu loh. Belum triple toh?
Triple susah. Kalau Pak Singgi,
sebagai apanya, Bu?
Coba?
Pak Singgi sebagai pembimbing kedua.
Iya, tapi saya ada FGD Bu Manik, jadi susah nanti konsentrasinya kalau harus konsentrasi penuh, tapi kalau setengah-setengah konsentrasinya bisa. Itu anaknya Widat tadi udah saya, anak Widat sih udah, Widat orangnya rapi. Terus okay. Juga dia udah selesai. Jadi bisa. Cuman dia belum 16 kali, ini hanya khususan ya. Ini apa namanya? Jadi benar-benar hanya untuk nolongin aja. Sebenarnya enggak boleh. Febi, kamu masih di situ?
Halo, Mas Febi.
Febi udah siap.
Kita harus diperbaiki tuh loh. Febi hari apa, Bu?
Febi tanggal 20 ya.
20 apa?
20 Oktober.
Febi 20 Oktober tuh. Kita coba loh.
Oh, baik, Prof.
Nanti perbaiki dulu ya.
Oke. Iya. Febi sama Siti. Apa? Jadwal sama Pak Beni kapan?
Oh, silakan. Prof Beni itu Rabu malam nyediakan Zoom. Oleh, tadinya mau ngobrol sama
enggak. Barungan sama Bu Nini biar ngirim dulu draftnya, nanti tinggal ngobrol.
Iya, nanti aku share ya ininya dari Pak Beni Rabu malam. Kirim aja dulu sekarang. Kirim aja
Bu Nini biar setor dulu ke Bu Aris.
Enggak usah, langsung ke Prof Beni aja. Pakai WA, pakai WA juga nggak apa-apa kayaknya.
Oh iya.
Nah, nanti chat yang Rabu malam itu tak share di ini di grup ya, kalau ada yang mau. Ya.
Ini ya.
Ya, oke.
Okay. Saya leave ya. Saya tadi Superindo belum ditaruh dagingnya, mudah-mudahan belum basi.
Tadi tuh macet. Ya udah, saya leave juga deh.
Ya.
Bikin laporan.
Terima kasih Pak Heru, Bu Mani, ya hadir. Bu Nini.
Ada Bu Nini, dikirim aja dulu.
Ampun.
Apa, lewat WA, Bu?
Oh, saya juga hadir loh. Pak Bambang, ada Pak Bambang.
Langsung Prof Beni apa Bu Aris?
Enggak, Prof Beni aja bilang mau ikutan yang Rabu malam gitu. Mau ikutan, bincang-bincang Rabu malam gitu. Dia kemarin nyediain Zoom meeting sih Rabu malam.
Ini diskusinya jadi webinar kedua nih.
Tapi nggak ada bayarannya Pak. Ini
udah gak maksudnya banyak yang dengerin ya. Yang nggak apa-apa sih.
Nggak, ini untuk itu Pak, diskusi paper Pak. Kalau mau ikutan silakan.
Diskusi paper gimana maksudnya?
Itu kan Bu Nini mau mendiskusikan paper yang dia.
Internasional.
Mau bikin
Kapan itu?
kebetulan Rabu malam itu
malam
Beni ya. Prof Beni ngajak diskusi soal ada satu paper, terus kalau Bu Nini ikutan aja di situ barengan.
Gitu. Itu papernya siapa?
Ada paper Bu Nini, ada paper
Bu Nini dan aku.
Ya, Bu Nini dan Pak Heru.
Good, good.
Tim sukses. Bu Nini sebagai tim sukses.
Pak Heru penulis pertama. Ya, saya ngintil.
Nunggu Lianes. Kurang semangat bantu waktu.
Aku yang penulis kedua, Pak Heru masuk toh ya.
Ya.
Kalau penulis nanti Bu Nini yang penulis pertama, dari Bu Nini penulis pertama. Ya, gitu.
Akhirnya oke, berarti ini langsung Pak Deni ya. Makasih ya, Bu. Ya, ya.
Langsung aja Bu, langsung aja.
Nah. Di share aja infonya kapan nama. Ya,
baik, baik, baik. Iya. Oke.
Ya. Izin live ya.
Ya, aku juga. Monggo. Baik, asaran. Ya.
Cek. Keluar juga ya. Mau makan siang, belum makan ini.